This is not a test. This is your emergency broadcast system announcing the commencement of the annual purge.
Because I just went gay all of a sudden.
Weapons of class 4 and lower have been authorized for use during the purge.
We use words like honor, code, loyalty.
Government officials of ranking 10 have been granted immunity from the purge and shall not be harmed.
There is no racial bigotry here. Here you are all equally worthless.
Commencing at the siren, any and all crime, including murder, will be legal for 12 continuous hours.
You can act like a man! What's the matter with you?
Police, fire, and emergency medical services will be unavailable until tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. when the purge concludes.
General, would you care to step outside?
Blessed be our new founding fathers and America, a nation reborn. May God be with you all.
Yeah, Marco, I didn't have an option that I didn't record for some reason, but I do for Brian and Thomas.
Because there's three whiteys and a beaner, that's why.
And that is okay. Where the episode's gonna start to play. Oh, so I was debating back and forth on the topic for this episode. First of all, I had one, and then I told Matt, and he's like, "That's a good one," and then I lost it.
But in our defense, we were both kind of drunk at the time.
I was just saying, like, we're. I'm like, yeah. And Matt, you're the backup. You didn't.
We were. Working on our.
On your tolerance.
So today, this Locker Room Podcast was my turn, and we invited an old friend to join us from the previous Manstalgia Podcast. So I am Tom, as always.
I'm Matt.
Marco.
Rooch. Oh, Brian. Not using names.
That's Uncle. That's Uncle Fester. Yeah,
now we have known Brian for I've known Brian almost as long as I've known Matt, and I think I met Matt about a year and a half before I met Brian in high school, and so the only person I've known longer than these two idiots is Marco. Brian, in case you're wondering about his connection to War Stories, we have never had him on, but we want to, because he has some very interesting experiences. It's just finding out which ones he can talk about as a private contractor for the U.S. military. And is that about as much as we can say?
For right now, yeah, probably best keep it low pro, you know.
We used to have a joke on the old podcast that we'd send a free t-shirt to anybody who could guess what Brian did for a living. So if we accidentally call him Roach, you'll know why. We've been calling him Roach.
Been my nickname since high school.
Yeah. Show the tattoo. Show everybody, the folks at home, the tattoo. And for those of you who are listening to this instead of looking at it on YouTube, that is in fact a chrome cockroach.
And
then the word Roach. So, anyway, I lost the topic that Matt and I were enjoying a day by the pool.
So this is a backup topic?
Yeah, it was a good one. It was a good one too.
That's all we remember is we both were in our cups and going, "Dang, that's a good idea," and then it was gone. This is a. I was like, okay.
I'm so now the. Yeah, but the new policy is now whenever we come up with an idea for a topic, we're going to text it to somebody else. Mm-hmm. That way it's there forever.
The wife and I and the guys at work, we have that same thing. Someone comes up with a good idea, immediately, like D-glove, immediately text it out.
Yeah.
So there's a record of it.
So that's kind of where we ended up coming to the current topic, where I was sitting there racking my brain. And then I came up with two topics, and then I pitched one of them, and you guys liked it. And so the two topics were, and I'll save the other one for later, but here it is on record. The runner-up topic that we didn't pick was...
And you don't have the drunken. This is not the drunken topic. This is not the drunken. Okay.
This is still not the magical drunken topic.
Got it. So we still have no idea what the fuck that was.
Still have no idea what the fuck that was.
There's something that's supposed to be next level. We may never know.
We may never know. Or at one point, somebody's going to suggest that. I'm going to go, that's what it was.
Fuck no. Yep. We're going to be halfway through this episode. You're going to be like, you know what? I just remembered.
Yeah.
Switch gears.
And I'm babysitting.
Being magical drunk, is that like waking up on somebody's front lawn three cities over?
I'm babysitting my dog, by the way, so I apologize if you hear a puppy howling because she's mad that I'm not playing with her. But huskies are notoriously loud. Matt met her. She's a chatty Cathy for sure. But the runner-up topic was going to be, you don't have the right to be offended. I don't give a shit.
Okay, that's pretty vague and open and
right. It was just going to be everybody's, well, with everybody going, that's offensive. You can't do that. The topic was going to be, nobody gives a shit if you're offended.
Right. And we're going to break down what you can actually be offended by and what you shouldn't be offended by.
Right. What's reasonable.
Okay.
So that's a future
That makes sense. This is column A, you're a bitch. Column B, you have a legitimate right to be upset.
Exactly.
It's
the question is legitimate gripe or you're being a bitch.
Fuck, I wish we would have. I'm like, that's pretty good. I wish we would have prepared that for today. I'm like,
but that's the thing. That's going to have to be like a prepared, like everybody's going to need to make some notes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. You know what really, you know what really burns my biscuits?
Like the old segment. You know what really grinds my gears?
You know what really grinds my gears?
But today's topic that I chose is the lie of self-esteem. And I picked it because I don't know if you guys follow Chad Robichaud. He's a former recon Marine and MMA fighter. He's a motivational speaker and runs the Mighty Oaks Foundation that John went to and a lot of other vets went to. And we went and did an interview with them. Really great guys. They take, you know, police officers and firefighters and military veterans on like week-long retreats to kind of refocus and retrain their brain to deal with all the crap that they've seen through their time deployed and career. Great program. But Chad is one of the founders of it. And he's also a motivational speaker and all this other stuff. He posted a thing that said, a common lie, believe in yourself. And then he posted scripture from Proverbs, whoever trusts in his own mind is a fool, but he who walks in wisdom will be delivered. Now, I was looking at that. I'm going, yeah, believe in yourself is kind of a big lie because, you know, everybody goes, oh, just believe in yourself. Well, yeah, but what about the people that we all saw American Idol? There's lots of people that believed in themselves and sucked. So the just believe in yourself is a lie. But it struck me that I've been saying for years, and we should talk about the fact that self-esteem is a lie. And we will open it up by me saying this. We have been told, or we've been telling kids for probably the last at least 40 years in the educational system, if they feel good about themselves, they will do great things. And my contention is that's completely bass-ackwards, because if you do great things, you will feel good about yourself. So I want to discuss whether you guys believe that just having self-esteem is going to be enough to actually get kids to accomplish things, number one. And number two, if the lie of self-esteem does more harm than good.
Okay. Well, I think that starting out, I mean, look, attitude's everything. So of course, if you have a positive attitude about what you're going to try to accomplish, you're more likely to set yourself up for success. But just this, that what you just said goes along with telling kids, you know, you can be anything you want in the world. No, you can't. You have the opportunity to try to be anything you want in the world. But some dumb motherfuckers are not going to be doctors. That's just how it is.
And I think that's exactly the point right there too. So many people that I see in my career field, you know, I had a guy in training for almost 2 years and we wouldn't fire him. it just because, you know, they thought that he could do something. But 3 years in training, it takes most people, you know, 4 or 5 months to do. It's just
and he probably he believed in himself, I'm sure, but at the end of the day,
We think he was just scamming the system after a certain point, but you know.
Yeah. But I mean, yeah.
After 2 months when he realized he couldn't do it, he's like,
right.
Well, they haven't noticed yet. Let's just see how long it goes. They finally fire him and he's like, dude, I've been waiting for this shoe to drop for like 2.5 years.
Right.
You guys are way late. Well, okay. So let's go back to what I said earlier about, you know, the big lie of believe in yourself, right? There's lots of people that believe in themselves. I heard a great quote because I listened to the Dennis Miller podcast. That's how a lot of our audience found us. And that he had a guest on who said, you can love something and be terrible at it, right?
Right.
And I was thinking about like how I am with hockey. I love watching hockey and I even love playing hockey, but I wasn't any good at it. I was never going to join the NHL. I was barely good enough for beer league, you know? So you can really love something and not be good at it. However, what happens when you're told your whole life, if you just believe in yourself and feel good about yourself, you can do whatever you want. What happens when you believed in yourself as hard as they told you to, and you had just, you know, all the self-esteem in the world that they told you to, and you fail? What does that do?
That's two different things. Telling someone to believe in themselves, is more of a motivation to go and start building the foundation of working towards whatever your goal is. I can personally speak to this because switching careers at 30 and going through an apprenticeship to become a tattoo artist, there's a lot of times that I had self-doubt whether I was doing the right thing. And there are moments where I didn't think I was going to quote unquote make it. The late hours, I can, any one of us, anyone here.
Oh, I knocked over the microphone. Sorry.
any one of us here.
How unprofessional.
Any one of us here. We all have that. We can all relate, you know, within our jobs or something that we've done in our lifetimes where it has taken more than just an inner on switch to help us move forward.
Yeah, but I think that's just external motivation. That's not necessarily like okay, believe in yourself, I guess, is a platitude. Like, okay, you tell somebody, hey, you need to have confidence and try, you know, but I think there's a fundamental difference between telling somebody to have some confidence, you know, start believing in themselves and put in the work. 'Cause that's what you're talking about. You're talking about the self-doubt that comes along with, am I making the right decision? I'm making this huge change in my career. I'm making this huge change in my life. And let me tell you, I went through it at 35 because I thought I was going to be a cop till I was 55. And then when I had to retire early for medical reasons, I was very insecure about what the hell am I going to do with the rest of my life. So I get that. But what I'm talking about is telling somebody, just believe in yourself. Just have self-esteem. If only you had enough self-esteem, you'd be able to do anything. And instead of saying, hey, self-esteem is all fine and dandy and you need to have self-esteem, but don't forget that the most important part of success is work.
Well, yeah, and you got to have the motivation to do it too. Some people, you can like whatever you want and just not have the motivation to get up and go do it.
Let's go back to Marco's example. Marco, you said you changed careers at 30 and became an apprentice, started tattooing. Now, anybody, by the way, little plug, Art of Marco Antonio on Instagram if you want to see the amazing. And if you've been looking at his amazing artwork for years on me, the audience just didn't know it yet.
Shameless plug.
Same thing with Matt. And you can find him in Austin. plug. No, okay, so at some point you would have had to have decided, because you've been an artist your whole life. Ever since I've known you, you've been drawing, right?
Yes, but it wasn't, as you remember, it wasn't my primary form of art for a very, very long time.
No, it was not. You and I were both, primary form of art was music, but you enjoyed drawing. And at some point you said, music's not doing what I want it to do.
Mm-mm. Gotta go.
Which admittedly, I mean, you can have all the talent in the world and never make it in the music business.
Sure.
So we can at least establish that talent alone isn't enough in a creative endeavor, right? You have to have an audience. You have to have somebody that wants what you're selling. Mm-hmm. But you also had a talent for drawing, and then you parlayed that talent for drawing into a career as a tattoo artist. And you said you apprenticed. At one point during your apprenticeship, would you have cut bait and said, I'm not
several times. Just,
right.
Several times. And it, we all go through self-doubt, you know, at some point or another, we all go through, am I doing the right thing? But I remember distinctly going with the subject. I remember distinctly, I was having a really, 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 really tough time where I felt very stagnant. Like I felt like I wasn't moving forward. I was working two jobs at 30 years old. You know, you're not making much as an apprentice for tattooing, and you already have bills, credit cards, car payments, so on and so forth. You got to pay. So I had two jobs, and it was very taxing. You know, working a cubicle farm during the morning time, and then working at a tattoo shop until midnight. Closing, getting out of there at 1-2 o'clock in the morning just to be back in the office at 8. And it was my ex at the time, which is an amazing, amazing gal, that's very much supported me, very, very much supported me. And she was the one that said, you know, sometimes you need to just step back, take a deep breath, and believe in yourself. You know, believe in yourself. And if you cannot believe in yourself, just look around you to all the people that believe in you.
Aha, that's a key factor too. Look around for other people that believe in you, right?
Right, and it's through, I mean, you can call it what you can call it, but it was through that that I gained a little confidence. Mm-hmm. You can also say, you know, a little self-esteem. Mm-hmm. little confidence, little self-esteem to kind of push through that hurdle at that, you know, that hurdle at that time. But as far as like the believing yourself and you can do anything, I mean, it's a great idea to tell somebody, especially when they're young, because it's just basically positive reinforcement to try different stuff, to get out there and do things, to get that experience things, to get, you know, I just don't know. I don't know if it's so much negative, you know, I'm not really finding, a negative with it, especially now having kids. And my dad told me that, and you know, y'all know what my dad did. And yeah, you can say it's through hard work. You can say it's through, you know, determination. You can say that's however you want to say it, but, you got to walk with some kind of air of self-esteem to be able to pull some shit off sometimes.
You know, I don't know. I'm kind of on the fence about that one, because when it comes to, you know, what I was always told was, you know, you should have self-esteem just by virtue of the fact and just by the parents kind of telling you, you know, you're special to me. You're a good kid. I like you. You know, other people are going to like you. It's fine. But as far as the rest of the world's concerned, you got to prove it every day. And nobody's going to hand you anything. It's going to take hard work. And, you know, telling my family I wanted to play music, you know, since I was a little kid, they were always like, that's great. You have a lot of musical talent. You have a lot of musical ability. But have a backup plan, because it's a hard business and not everybody makes it, and find something else you're good at. And, you know, a lot of people are like, well, that's terrible. They should have just, you know, believed in your dreams. I'm like, they did believe in my dreams, but they told me to be practical. And I think that's a missing component when you just tell a kid all you need is self-esteem and you can do great things. What you need to tell them is you should have self-esteem because you're a unique individual with a lot of things to offer. The only question is, what do you have to offer the rest of the world that they're going to want, you know? And that's going to take hard work and dedication, especially, like you said, if you want to be a doctor, you got to go to damn medical school and you got to put in the hours. Nobody shows up to medical school and they just hand them things except for Doogie Howser.
Well, and you got to have the talent for it too. I mean, you just don't want to walk in, you know, do all these years of medical school and then find out, hey, you know, I got a shaky arm. I can't perform surgery.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that comes down to like everybody, I have the belief that everybody has a talent at something. Everybody's good at something. You know, there are people that are great with numbers that are accountants, that are great with numbers that are accountants. I'm not great with numbers. I need an accountant, you know? Obviously, as you guys know, we talked about, I'm an artist, so I have the visual eye and the ear, you know, as far as arts is concerned, and that's my niche, if you will. You know, my father was an athlete for a long time, so, and his whole thing is, as far as business is concerned, what he passed on to me is, if you concentrate on your product, if we're talking about business, if you concentrate on your products, your clients will come. And saying, so if you can transfer it to, if you work hard, you can transfer it if you work hard, right? If you work hard at your craft, you know, saying people will seek you out, or you will be successful, or at least you'll have the chance and the opportunity to be successful, right? But then there's the other side of what my dad did. And he never looked for acceptance from other people. He just worked hard to see how far he could go and how far he could take it. Right. And that's a different way. And for people that are like, well, what did your father do? People are watching, like, I don't get it. So the background is, my dad was an Olympic athlete. My dad went to the Olympics, right? So my dad was, I just found out that my mom and my dad, that he was I didn't know this, but he was a record holder, Panamanian Games. He's a Panamanian Games.
The Pan American
champion.
No, Pan American.
Yeah, sorry. I think of the Pan American Games record holder and world champion several times. I didn't know that, but. Yeah, several times. So with that background, with the athletic, you know, performance kind of background, his mentality when we were growing up is that, put your mindset to it. You know, saying you can do anything. You can do, like, and here's what it comes down to. He said, you can do anything that you set your mind to. You can achieve anything that you set your mind to. But at the same time, he would tell us, I was good at certain events, and we were missing athletes in other events, and I got thrown into doing other events, and I sucked at those, you know. But it's something that you still have to try. You still have to do. You still have to get over. As we all know, you learn more from failures than you will ever learn from just blank achievements. And what I mean by blank achievements is, if you stumble into a situation or you stumble into a job. You know, like Brian over there, which, you know, collecting, you know, rare species of cockroaches from, you know, Madagascar, you know, in order to turn them into small bombs for, you
or
know,
something.
For nations. Right. Exactly. To turn them into something, allegedly. Right. Into something else. Then, there are some people that will show up and go into training for months and then realize, like, you know, I spend time into doing this. We hear all the time about people going to college, and I'm going to go to college to be a doctor. And they go, yeah, I actually, when it came time to the practical application of surgery, I can't do it. So now, you know, now what I do is I'm a pharmacist. I'm like, wow, that's how you want to be a proctologist, and now you're a pharmacist. That's a turn. You're still in medical, but that's a turn. And we've heard that all the time.
When you say, I'm a gunfighter, look, I can't do it anymore. What do you mean? It's steady as a rock. Yeah, but I shoot with this hand. Exactly. There comes a point at which you're not cut out for what you want to do.
Right.
I worked with young men, and I tried to train them, and they're most of the time they made it through if they had been through the academy, but there were training washouts because they were not cut out to be police officers. They might be perfectly good social workers. They might be perfectly good, you know, grocery store employees. There's a host of other things people are good at. You know, I'll give you a perfect example. I enjoy working with my hands. I enjoy crafting and building things. And if I work really hard at developing the skills when I started, you know, working with leather as a hobby. I had a knack for it and I enjoyed it. But what I found that I didn't enjoy was people paying me to do things and then dictating how I did it, because it was a hobby. I liked making the things that I liked making. So it could never have been a business for me.
That's a struggle. That's a struggle with every artist. As soon as you, I always tell people like, oh, you get to do everything you want every single day. I'm like, well, no, at the end of the day, I am a tattoo artist, but he who holds the pen that writes the checks tells me what it is that they want on them. At the end of the day, I am doing, unless you're mad, I am doing, unless you're mad, you're like, hey, I don't like this. I've had it for years. Can you just figure it out and cover it? Like, just figure this empty space out. I'm like, right. Oh, okay, sure. Yeah, why not? I understand it completely. And that's a whole nother topic as far as like when you're an artist and you're getting paid to do your art, it's, some people argue that's no longer your art. You're now being told what to do. You're just being blessed as performing it to your style in your certain way. And the subject matter is theirs.
But the self-esteem isn't going to change the fact that if you don't have talent, it's not going to work.
No, but the self-esteem will allow you to try different stuff out and not be afraid of failing. And if you do fail, take the lesson from it and try the different stuff out. My dad never said, you know, have self-esteem, go be a fucking jet fighter and get my 320-pound ass into a fucking cup, squeeze into a cup. By the way, it'd be like when I come out.
it'd be like when you crack the tube of crescent rolls.
Yeah, oh, God.
We used to joke that every car you drove, you looked like Donkey Kong in Mario Kart.
Oh my God. What was that Escort that I had for a while where like I put my hand out of the fucking window and I could almost reach the bottom of the door. Yeah. By the way, it was a Escort station wagon. And if I lean back, I can actually flip people off out the back window and I can actually up to the back window. That's how fucking tall I am.
I don't even think let me ask you this. The booger mobile.
That's true. Let me bring this up then. Cause I think that there's a difference between like, cause we're talking about confidence.
Sure.
And we're also talking about self-esteem, but we're also talking about work.
Well, let's establish the difference between the both of them. Between self-esteem and,
right.
And,
so I think,
and self-confidence.
And so I think confidence is like, a lessening or an ability to overcome fear, right? Because we all know the famous quote is fear is, bravery is not the absence of fear. Bravery is being afraid and saddling up anyway, right?
Yeah.
So if you weren't afraid, you wouldn't have to be brave. It doesn't take bravery when you're not afraid, right?
Sure.
So you have to be afraid to be brave. Well, if you're afraid to try something, because you don't have the confidence, then sometimes someone can come along and give you external encouragement, like in the form of saying, hey, what's the worst thing that can happen? You try and you fail and you do something else, but at least you'll know, you'll never have to wonder. But that's different than saying...
You could say that they're boosting your confidence though.
Yeah, exactly. I mean,
if you're playing on words, like if you don't have the self-confidence or you're lacking, well, I will say this, you're lacking, you need, let's do role-playing terms. You need a level 13 confidence in order to, Matt, where are you going? What is happening?
He's going to the bathroom.
Last podcast.
I'm about to.
So, again, this is funny. But if you need like a level 13 confidence to move forward with this one task and you're that one short, and I call my old buddy Thomas and I need a little bit of like, hey man, like can you get a couple seconds and da 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 da, and then my old boy over there is like, stop being a bitch. Get your ass in that door. Cause that's how we talk to each other. Stop being a fucking bitch. Suck it the fuck up. You can do it. Do your thing and go fucking do it. Boom. I just got a little bonus from him. We're going to the bathroom. We got a little bonus from him. and got a boost on my self-esteem, and And it's just so
But I think that's a boost to your confidence, not your self-esteem. Because your self-esteem is your image of yourself as a successful person. Like all these daily affirmations. You're good enough, you're smart enough, and gosh darn it, people like you. Well, okay, number one, you don't fucking know if you're good enough until you actually put in the work and try.
Sure.
Number one, that's the easiest thing in the world to say. You don't know if you're good enough. Number two, right? You may not be smart enough.
I'm not shaking my head at you.
Wait. Why don't we look up the? Hold on, I gotta aim. Why don't we look up the definition?
Wait, I gotta aim.
Wait, ladies and gentlemen, hold on. Are you really gonna? This is the locker room, folks, and there are bathrooms in the locker room. Apparently,
right.
So, I can't.
I drink a lot of water, man.
I hate you so much right now because you create editing problems for me.
I'm not going to sit down like a little bitch and pee.
Yeah, but you can't go before we leave.
He's still going.
You've got the bladder of a woman.
you drink like 2 gallons of water a day? Something like that.
2 gallons of water a day.
That's a lot of water.
Okay. Well, can you pee and then just hold off for one entire podcast hour and then start drinking the other 2.5 gallons?
Hey, look, I peed twice before we even got on.
Wow.
I'm gonna send him one of those fucking driving pee things, you know what I'm saying? Like one of those fucking that look like you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Hell yeah. Yep.
Just get yourself a Gatorade bottle and pee in that.
No. We'll get one of those like the G suits that the pilots wear with the tube going down their leg. Yeah. Let's get you one of those. Anyway.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry.
I think that you can go ahead. You look up the definition of self-esteem and you look up the definition of confidence. And
all right. Yes, Madison. Shit.
No, Matt said he wanted to do it.
Yeah, so. But I'm on my. We've had this discussion before.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So
Christ on a cracker.
T, fire off your rebuttal. I'm gonna look it up. So while you're doing your thing.
Well, my rebuttal was fired up until it got pissed all over.
Yeah.
My bladder waits for no one.
No. So if maybe you're not smart enough, right? Maybe people don't like you. We need to understand that. Telling kids, okay, you can't tell a child who's a fucking asshole to just feel good about himself and people will like him, because guess what? That child is a fucking asshole. At some point, you need to look the 8-year-old in the face and say, stop pulling Susie's hair.
Wow, this is interesting.
And farting in your friends' faces, and maybe they'll like him. Well, maybe not the farting in your friends' face, because we still haven't stopped doing that. But you get what I'm saying? Like, you tell kids... Go ahead.
No, please. I interrupted you. Go ahead.
Oh, no. I was just saying, you can't tell kids, you know, you're smart enough. Kids fucking know when they're dumb. I'm not kidding. Kids see other kids good at things that they're not good at. It's like when I would see Marco draw. I knew Marco was like, I like drawing. I like doodling. But I would see Marco draw and I go, he's way better at it than I am. And it wasn't a blow to my self-esteem. It wasn't a blow to my ego because I already had confidence in the things that I was good at. I didn't have to be jealous of you. I didn't have to feel bad about myself because you had talent. I just knew, yeah, I'm not as good as him. So if you take a kid who looks at all the other kids in class and goes, yeah, I'm not as smart as a lot of these kids, and you tell him, no, you are smart. You are good. Just feel that you're smart enough. Just tell yourself you're smart enough. You can't fucking look yourself in the mirror and say you're smart enough and gain IQ points. It just doesn't happen.
Sure.
Right? So when you tell these kids this stuff, instead of saying something like, okay, maybe you're not as good at math, or you're not as good at, you know, this or history or whatever. Maybe you're better at these other things. My son's way better at math than I am. But damn it, he can't tell a joke to save his life, you know? And so I'm constantly, when he tells a joke and he looks at me waiting for a big laugh, and I go, okay, here's why it wasn't funny. And people are like, wait, you tell your kid his shit isn't funny? You don't just courtesy laugh? I'm like, hell yeah, I do. And they go, well, but that's not good for his self-esteem. I'm all, no, but it's good for his sense of humor.
It's good for his delivery.
Right.
Yeah.
All right.
We can't shield kids from criticism. Go ahead.
Oh, that's true. The term self-esteem and self, there's a word here that I don't know, that I don't think I've come across before. The term, so T, Matt, mm-hmm. you guys have always been my dictionaries. I look on to you.
Go.
No disrespect, Brian. The term self-confidence and self-esteem are often conflated.
Yeah, conflated. Confused between each other.
Yeah. Why do you fucking use confused? You know what? they're just trying to throw a brown brother off. Anyways.
They're trying to
just kill my self-esteem, Marco.
Fuck, man. You know what? My confidence just fucking plummeted reading the rest of this. That. So anyways, so the term self-esteem, self-confidence and self-esteem are often conflated. Confidence is a measure of faith in one's own ability, where esteem is about our sense of self.
Right, your sense of self-worth, right?
Right. So yeah. Knowing that you can do it versus thinking that you can do it?
No, I would argue that it's your confidence or self-confidence is your belief in your ability to try something or to do something. And self-esteem is the idea that if you fail, you're worthless.
Oh, I understand. So, okay, yeah. Self-esteem is like, I like myself, period. And then confidence is like, I've done this shit or something like this before. Or you know what? I got this. I can move forward with this.
Right, exactly. If you tell somebody, if you just have a healthy sense of your self-worth, you can mm-hmm. do anything. No, if you have a healthy knowledge of your strengths and weaknesses and realize that everybody is different and that's what gives you self-worth is your differences, great. But a man's got to know his limitations, to quote a famous film. And if you don't know your limitations and you fall flat on your face, you don't have any resiliency because to me, a kid goes, oh my God, I believed in myself. I have good self-worth. I know I'm worth something. My mom told me so. I got a trophy for going to D-ball for no reason, right? I should be successful. Why am I not successful? Well, because they forgot to mention that in addition to knowing your self-worth, you have to put in time. You have to put in effort. You have to put in work. And guess what? Just because you feel good about yourself doesn't mean you're actually going to succeed.
Right. But yeah. No, the self-esteem is a starting point. That's the starting point, is have a sense of self-worth. And then from there, you try and fail. You know, the old saying, you know, you fall down 7 times, you'd get up 8.
I'm with that. It seems like it's a loop. They're kind of conjoined twins, because you need, or you don't need, but it helps to have self-esteem to go ahead and do things to build up your confidence, right? Confidence, as we said, is just faith in one's own abilities. Eventually, when you do something enough or try different stuff out within that same realm, then it starts building, you can say that it starts building up your self-esteem when you're in that certain scenario. For example, if you're kind of shy or an introvert in certain situations, but you get into that one, like, you know, and you hear it all the time, this person's kind of shy until you get them to this one situation and they're talkative and they become like a monster because they're in their comfort zone, quote unquote.
Yeah, so it's called drinking.
the three wise men, they're called that for a reason. So... But I mean, you could say that if you build enough confidence, because you build confidence, obviously, based on this definition, you build confidence, the measure of faith in one's own abilities, right? So like you build up your abilities. Like you said, you try, you fail, you pick yourself back up, or you don't, you know, and you move on to something else. You gain skill, right? You level up, you gain skill, you get better at certain skills, at certain days, certain, whatever the skills are. Well, this applies to everything. This applies to all day occurrences of everything, from writing, reading, you're right, Roach?
Oh, I'm good, dude.
No, he's not all right. Actually, we didn't even mention you're joining us from a hotel room in North Dakota because your ass is in quarantine.
I am in quarantine.
But you don't even have it.
No, I don't have it. I ran into somebody at work who popped hot, and I get thrown in the penalty box for 2 weeks. So.
All right. Well, anyway, going back, Marco.
When you say pop hot, did somebody walk in on him in the bathroom?
Tested positive.
for jerking off?
My ass hurts.
Where was I before I was interrupted?
I get what you're saying but I know it's kind of a loop, but it also kind of isn't, because to me, what we've been teaching kids is an incomplete message. We're missing the part where we have to be tough on them, and we have to expose them to criticism, and we have to tell them rub some dirt on it. We have to tell them to walk it off. We have to tell them those things instead of just saying, and this is the lie part. This is what I say is the lie. Okay. If you just believe in yourself, you will do great things. And what I've just been saying is this for years, the simple act of having self-esteem and believing that you're worth something is not enough to allow you to do great things. Nobody just wakes up and does great things ever.
Yeah. It's part of the equation.
I wake up every morning and I drop a great fucking deuce. You know what I'm saying? I wake up before my kids do. And I got to tell you what happens in the bathroom. It's fucking sheer greatness.
Okay. With the exception of your morning Duke.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody, yeah. I mean, you have to get, Matt, you just posted a picture of yourself drenched in sweat, hitting the heavy bag, right?
Right. Right.
I remember you telling me.
Go ahead.
I was just saying, I remember the first time you told me you ever worked on a heavy bag and you were like, oh my God, that thing kicked my ass.
Yeah. And now I kick the heavy bag's ass.
Right. I didn't know they swung back.
I was going to bring up, well, when you push them, they come back at you. I was going to bring up my new, favorite thing to do a couple times a week is swimming. And I've been going into the ocean and swimming. Now shark I bait. Believe uh-huh. When I started out, I believed I was capable of swimming a 5K in one go, you know, which is 3.2 miles, whatever. But I didn't just start out doing that. I started out doing a half mile, then a mile and a half. And, you know, last week I did 3.36 miles in the ocean. Now, I believe I can do more, but when I go swimming tomorrow, I'm damn sure not going to try to swim 6 miles because I still have that belief that I can do it. I have that confidence. I have that self-esteem, but then there's also that, the reality check of, I still have to put in more work. You know, if any of you guys were to go out swimming with me, and I believe you could swim that distance too, but it'd be foolish.
Eventually,
just, you know,
eventually
just to distance.
Allegedly.
Right.
Well, I can barely do any push-ups anymore.
Here's the thing. I guarantee you can at least float that distance. You're a buoyant motherfucker, but.
Oh yeah, easily. I'm a wave riding motherfucker.
No, I meant Brian. You know, but that's the thing. That's the key point. You believed that you could swim a 5K eventually. Right. Right?
Eventually.
It wasn't the belief that you could do it right then and there just by force of willpower. You didn't get in the damn ocean and say, if I just believe hard enough in my own self-worth, I will swim a 5K today, having no practice, no preparation, nothing whatsoever, right? So,
right.
I mean, that's a little bit of an extreme example because it involves a lot of physical exertion. But if you extrapolate that to somebody who wants to be a famous painter or somebody that wants to be, you know, it's not like, there's some things that you will never be able to develop the skill to do. I'm not an athlete, right? I'm an athletic supporter, but I'm not an athlete.
You like holding up balls? Is that?
No, that's the whole joke. If you can't be an athlete, be an athletic supporter.
Yeah.
But I'm not super athletic guy. I just never have been. I can produce the shit out of this show, and I can come up with the intro and do the editing and write music and all these other things. But God damn it, I will be picked last for basketball every time. And when I was a kid, it bothered me. But what was great is I had a dad who said, hey, I like sports and I'm not really good at them either. I'm more of an artistic musical person, and that's fine. You can like it. You can do it. You can enjoy it. Just understand that you may not be as good at it as other people, and have fun. That was much better advice than no. If you just believe in yourself, you'll be great at it.
Right.
I think
that's more. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, I would have believed my dad more if my dad had said to me, if you just believe in yourself, you'll be great at it. I would have said, Dad, you're full of shit. I've seen me run. Right. I've seen you try to dribble a ball, and I've seen kids that just pick it up and they get it right. That hand-eye motor skill, spatial intelligence, all that kind of stuff. But if my dad had said to me, son, it doesn't matter if you're ever going to be great at it. You may never play in the NBA, but if you put in hours and hours and hours of practice, I guarantee you won't be picked last. That,
right. Yeah.
That I would have believed.
Yeah, because I think when my whole takeaway from this is with the lie of self-esteem becomes the lie when you just keep telling that other person, no, you just have to, you know, feel good about yourself. You just have to believe in yourself. You just have to. When you say you just have to do that, that's going to be more detrimental to the person's self-esteem in the long run, because they're going to keep failing at it because they're just believing in themselves. And then that's when you're fucking somebody up, is when you say you just have to believe in yourself, which I think is what, you know.
So maybe that's where it's at right there. I mean, there's a lot more that goes into it than just believing yourself. You got to put
right.
in
the that's,
work. You got to put
yeah,
in
that's
effort.
A start. That's a start. That, I think
that's what I was going to say.
You know, you have to have that I can do attitude. Mm-hmm. And you know that, yes, I believe in myself, and
right.
I'm going to go, you know, try this. And if you keep failing, you're doing yourself a disservice. You're like, yeah, but I believe myself so much. Cool, but practice, you know.
That's what I'm taking away from. That's what I'm taking away from this is exactly what Matt you just said, which is basically it's a start. Telling somebody, you know, believe in yourself is the first step. Believe in yourself and get out there and try and do your thing. Oh, you know, I came up short. It didn't work out the same. We lost. So, you know, I got picked last. Well, and then Tom, what you were saying, there's the next step. It's not going to just come to you. Getting right. out there and trying, getting out there and putting yourself out there is only the first step. And you have to prove to yourself that you are able, not just willing to, but you are able to just walk out there, walk on the court, walk into a boardroom, walk into a meeting, you know, saying walk into whatever situation you need to walk into. Is that's the first step. And I think that's what it is. I think that the giving somebody self-esteem and saying you can do anything that you set your mind to, you can start walking the path.
Start with believing you can, and then put one foot in front of the other.
And then start working.
Yep.
And then get your ass to work. You know, believe that you can do it. Get your ass to work.
Yeah, because even all these athletes that have this natural talent, they right. if it was that easy and that natural, they wouldn't practice. Everybody right. practices their craft. I mean, Marco, you don't just tattoo. You draw for just the sake of drawing, and you're trying new techniques, and you're honing your skill and refining things. You know,
no,
it's. No, you're not. You just whip it out. You just wake up to excellence, you know, and just
fuck, dude. I'm using the force. I'm out here like. I look at my client and be like, well, thank you for the confidence. I'm about to start. Good luck to both of us.
No, so you just say don't. Side. You just say, Marco. You just tell him, don't worry. I really believe in myself. This is going to be just fine.
No, I tell him, I believe in you. I tell him, you know what? I believe in your choices. I believe in your choice of choosing me.
There we go.
Good luck.
I believe you chose the right person, and that right. is your first That was your first success, was choosing me.
That's it. You know, you
what do you tell them when they choose the wrong artwork for their tattoo, though?
That they're stupid.
Pay me.
I'm like, well,
okay. Wait.
I'm sorry. It's the old Caddyshack line. Is there any money in it for me?
Yeah. So, but here's why I say it is a big lie, because like we said, we have been selling an incomplete message for 40 right. years, right? These kids that grew up after us, right? After our generation, because we're all at the tail end of Gen X, the millennials that came along that were told that they were going to, you know, just, you know, oh, self-esteem is the most important thing. If you just have self-esteem, it's the most important thing. Da, 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 da. It was an incomplete message, and they weren't ever given criticism, and they were never prepared for failure.
The participation trophy generation. That's what we call right. the participation trophy yeah. generation. Yeah.
Which means that subsequently, since they weren't prepared for failure, now they have all this self-esteem and they're not ready for failure. So when they do fail, oh my God, when they do fail, they're unprepared for it. They don't know how to recover from it.
Right. So I would say that, you know, our topic as when we started was the lie of self-esteem. I would say that it's not the lie of self-esteem. It's the maybe half message of
the shortcoming
because,
of the lesson
because
the incompleteness.
I don't want people to think that me personally thinks that, you know, self-esteem is bad and it's bullshit. And I don't think self-esteem is bullshit. I just think nope. it's only a small part of the equation for yes. success.
Yes. And I think that's what we broke down. I think that's,
yeah,
I think we're in agreement. I don't know about Tom. He's a bit of an asshole, but anyways,
Well, okay. So I think, let me put it to you this way. I believe that you do your children a better service when you tell them, I love you. You're worth something to me. Ultimately, that's what matters. You're worth something to me. The rest of the world is going to require that you prove it every day. So you can feel like you have an inherent intrinsic self-worth just based on the fact that you're my kid and I love you and that will never change. However, when you get to the real world, they don't give a shit, right? My son, right? ADD, totally, right? Same as me. What, squirrel? He will get distracted, right? And he knows that. And when he does get distracted, he'll say, oh, Dad, I got distracted. And I'm like, well, you're still going to get in trouble. And he's like, what? But you know, I get distracted. I know. And now you have to learn how to develop coping mechanisms and strategies to overcome being in the middle of a damn job that I've asked you to do and getting distracted and either doing a half-assed job or failing to complete it. Because when you get to the real world, your boss is going to go, I don't give a shit what happened. You got distracted, you're fired. And if I don't prepare him for that reality, if I don't tell him that your boss is just going to be an asshole, he's not going to care, then he's not going to understand why his boss fired him.
No? Or not necessarily he won't understand why his boss fired him. He won't understand how to
cope.
How to cope with it. Yeah, how to cope with it and how to rectify the situation and move forward.
Well,
yeah, well, that situation, he'll blame it. That's when, my boss was an asshole and fired me.
Right.
Only because I just did this.
Well, it's the old mentality of a teacher fails you. Like, oh, they failed me or I got an A. And we heard that. Oh,
right.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And that's huge.
Yeah. That's a very good point.
You know,
I like that, Marco.
Oh, that's
good. That's saucy.
Solid.
That's always the case. Like, what did you get? Oh, they failed me. No one ever says, I got an F. They say, they failed me.
Oh, my kids do.
good. That's good. That's a good thing. Like, most people say, I got an A or I got a B or I passed with a C. Like, you know what I'm saying? So that's, unfortunately, that's something that needs to be retrained and rethought as well too. It's like it's your merit. You know, you earned, you got what you earned.
I'll tell you what I do is when my I hear my kid playing video games, and he'll be playing Fortnite or something, right? Like all the other kids his age, and I'll hear him, "What? How did they get me? This controller's not working." And I went, and I go upstairs and I go, "You need to shut up." And he goes, "What?" And I'm like, "I don't want to ever hear you blame the equipment." And he goes, "What?" And I said,
"Blame the operator.
It is a weak craftsman that blames his tools." I told him, I said, "Don't ever get into this habit of, you know, how did this happen? It's my controller. It's the game. It's the server. No, you got your ass whooped. You got your ass whooped. Take the ass whooping." Go ahead.
It was funny. That just reminded me that when we were hanging out Saturday playing that fun underwater tag game, and I think it was at a point where you were either going to get another drink or you were in the shallow end or something, and I tagged your son, and he came up and he muttered, he's like bunch of cheaters. And I said, "Excuse me?" I said,
"Right?"
I said, "What do you mean cheaters?" He goes, "It's cheating." I said, "Well, I tagged you. Are you calling me a cheater?" And then he went underwater for a second, like mid-sentence. So I waited and, you know, came back up and I said, "Who's cheating?" He's like, oh, I said, "I tagged you. Are you calling me a cheater?" I said, "'Cause that's like, you're calling me a liar. You calling me a cheater?" "No." I'm like, "Dude, you got tagged. It's a game. Like, let's just move on. Like, I got tagged. I'm not going to cry about it, you know?"
Right.
I think it's just, you know, kind of goes on with that's, you know, some people have that mentality and good on you for calling them out on it.
And some kids, you know, have a harder time with that reality than others.
Mm-hmm.
Some kids have an easier time. Some kids just naturally go, "Oh, I screwed that up."
Yeah.
And some kids, they just naturally go, I got screwed. And if you don't identify which kind of kid you have, you don't know which ones you need to take down a peg or two on a regular basis.
You know, I've used this example at work because I work with several guys that are my age. It's tougher. It's tougher now because just the way the music scene has changed. But just go with me for a moment. Give me a little leniency, Your Honor. Let me go with this tale.
I'll allow it.
For a walk, Marco.
I'll allow it. I'll allow it, counselor, but you better get somewhere fast.
Hey, man. Keep your eye on the clock for me, will you? Because we know I'm the king of fucking bird walks. So, no, real
there
quickly. When we grew up, watching live music and watching live videos, you know, VHS of live music, bands playing live was really a big thing, you know?
Right.
Because
you couldn't download it and watch it on YouTube.
There was no YouTube. I don't remember ever seeing a musician that broke a string in the middle of the song, not, you know, either throw a guitar or not finish the song. They usually finish a solo with a hanging ass string off of it, dangling off. And then when they had the moment to, and we all know because we all play in the bands,
mm-hmm.
you had the moment to, then you ran off, you switched the fucking gear real quick, you went back at it, and you went back and did your thing. You know, it's the same thing. It's like you can't, your skill is your skill. Something happens, adapt and overcome. It's not it's not the equipment. It's not operator error. It's operator error, not equipment failure.
And you can get screwed by equipment failure. But a true professional, a true worker, somebody who really, you know, puts the time in, doesn't, you know, I've literally never seen a professional musician break a string, break a drum head, break a drumstick, and then just stop the song and go, sorry, I got to start over. I broke a string. No, the show must go on. I've seen plenty of amateur kids at high school talent shows do it. And I always go, well, that's the parents' fault. And everybody goes, why? And I go, because I tell my kids, I don't give a shit if you fall on your face and break your nose. If you're capable of continuing, just finish the damn show. And if you're not, we'll carry you off the stage in a stretcher or whatever. But, you know, if you can continue. Cry about it later. Be upset about the string breaking later. Be upset about, you know, missing a step or tripping or your you know, your costume malfunctioning or your bat, your glove slipping off or your hat slipping off in the middle of the baseball game, whatever it is, be pissed about it after. Right. And then figure out how it happened and make sure it doesn't happen again. If you're a musician, change your strings before the show.
I mean, that happened to us at Mancini's. I broke a string at Mancini's and I just strummed strings.
Yep. You know, so I think that all of these things, the big lie for self-esteem comes with the omission of the fact that self-esteem is something you gain when you do things, right? So for example, when you try, right? When you put in the work, and Matt, perfect example, you gained more self-confidence and a little bit of self-esteem when you decided you were going to try and swim. And then the next thing you know, you accidentally swam a 5K before you thought you could or intended to.
Right. 5.4, but whatever.
Sorry. 5.4.
Don't rob me of that 0.4.
I wouldn't dream
so
of
basically
it.
So basically, we're all in agreement that the lie is that self-esteem is it.
There you
the
go.
The lie is that self-esteem is it. There's,
exactly. Self-esteem is all
you need. That is it. No. The truth is that the self-esteem is only a small fraction of the overall proceeds, the process.
Yeah, there's a much bigger picture.
To get to whatever goal you are meant, not necessarily want to, but you are meant to achieve.
Right. Self-esteem will get your
pretty
hand.
Good. Wait, give me some fucking credit.
That was good. Wow. I was gonna piggyback on it.
Those philosophy classes in college finally paid off, huh?
Self-esteem will get your hand on the doorknob. That's your start when you're gonna walk out. That'll get your hand on the doorknob. That'll give you the confidence to, okay, I feel good about myself, I can do this. And then everything else from opening the door, stepping through, and carrying on is all about, you know, your confidence and then your skill, your talent, the work, you know, the perseverance.
No, see, I would argue that self-confidence gets your hand on the door. Self-esteem is what you get when you actually open the door and overcome that first fear, right? The self-worth, right, comes from doing the thing. The self-confidence may come from somebody going, you got this, you can do it. You know, the confidence part of it can come from a coach, can come from a peer, can come from an external source, right? That gives you the confidence to grab that doorknob, open that door, and go to that interview. The self-esteem comes when you walk out of that interview going, man, I was scared shitless, but I fucking nailed it. And then you get a little bit more self-esteem when you get a call back to speak to the president of the company. And then you get a little more self-esteem when you get the job. And then you get a little more self-esteem when you turn in that big project and then get a promotion. All that. That's where the self-esteem comes in. Because you had the confidence to go out and push yourself. The bitch is, if you fall flat on your face, don't lose the self-esteem. Because the self-esteem should come from the fact that you fucking tried it and other people didn't. You had the confidence to do it when other people didn't. You know? So you don't think
that you start out with a sense of good self-worth to even attempt anything else or to even put yourself out there?
I think that you should start off with a good sense of self-worth because you're a human being, right? Parents should do a good job of telling their kids, you're worth something to me. The rest of the world doesn't give a shit. However, I'm going to teach you the skills necessary to have the confidence to go into any situation and show them what you're worth, right? If your kids show people what they're worth, that self-esteem will naturally be, it's like a byproduct. It's like, you know, when you ferment alcohol, you know, when you ferment fruit and alcohol is the byproduct, you know, self-esteem is the byproduct of confidence and hard work.
Right. I was just saying that you should have that at the get-go. Because if you have no self-esteem, then you're dead in the water. You're dead in the water out the gate.
Can I give you guys a scenario?
Yeah.
Yes.
So you guys have both met my old apprentice.
Yes.
Right. So
we're talking about she.
She's very much a natural introvert. right?
Yes.
Right, right.
And she knew from a young age that she wanted to be a tattoo artist. From when she was in high school, actually, beginning high school, like 15, 16 years old. And she would come to the shop and get piercings because it was part of the scene and a certain look that she wanted. And then she went to hang out and she drew a little and she had a little drawings on her notepad. And eventually, when she turned 18 years old, she talked her mom into buying her for her 18th birthday, buying her a tattoo from me. And she'd been following me for a couple of years and she wanted me to teach her how to tattoo. She didn't know how to approach it. So she wound up getting a tattoo from me and then talking to me about what it takes to be an actual tattoo artist until I finally said, you know, I finally asked her towards the end of the session, are you thinking about becoming a tattoo artist? And she said, well, I don't, and she, this is her answer. I don't know if I'm good enough for it. I'd love to do it. It's something that I think would be really cool, but I don't know if I should do it, if I should pursue it. I don't think I'm good enough. And she had no confidence.
Not disappeared.
Sorry.
She had no,
I was sure you were going to come back to the meeting and be pooping. Anyway,
you could clearly say that she had no confidence in her artistic skill whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Even though she's a natural artist, she had no confidence in her natural skill, and her self-esteem was in the negative, to say the least. Right. You're going to say, Thomas, you're going to.
No, I just said right. I totally, yeah.
So time went by, she came back, and I think it wasn't the confidence. This is where I'm kind of backing Matt's, it's kind of, you guys are both right, because it's what I said originally, which is a big loop. Enough confidence will give you more self-esteem, but self-esteem can be a starting point, because she came back and knew that she didn't think artistically her skills were enough to, and didn't know it was going to be enough to carry her or make her a decent tattoo artist. But it was her muscling up a little bit of self-esteem, you know, that brought her back to the door for a touch-up, under the guise of a touch-up, and then to ask me if I would apprentice her, to which I said, fuck no.
Okay, but let me back up then, because I think you made my case a little bit better than I could, because I would argue that it wasn't self-esteem that brought her to you, it was desire that brought her to you. She had an overwhelming urge. If she didn't believe in her art skills, right, if she didn't have any confidence or feel that her art skills had any worth, what would bring her back to you to ask to become a tattoo apprentice and to get better? A desire to be a tattoo artist and become good enough to be a tattoo artist. So she had desire and she had bravery. She desired to become a tattoo artist and she was brave enough to ask you to help her. And even though you shot her down, her persistence paid off. And
cold.
She, yeah, but that's the thing. Her persistence won you over. She became an apprentice and is now a tattoo artist. And guess what she got out of that desire, confidence, persistence, and bravery? Self-esteem. I would drop the mic, but it's expensive.
Mine was only like $50. I'll drop mine.
But that's the thing. Like, it's there's a lot of this that is semantics. We get it.
Right.
We're not saying, and I
dare say that we are not saying that self-esteem is bad.
No. Right? Self-esteem is necessary.
Because somebody could hear some of the shit that we're saying, go, oh, these guys are like saying self-esteem is bullshit because the lie of self-esteem. So I just wanted to clarify.
I think we can all agree that either one of them can fuel the fire. It's the gasoline, you know, it's gasoline and alcohol. You know what I'm saying? Like, either one of them I think we all recognize that either one of them can kickstart, you know, can kickstart the fire. But it's up to you, again, right. Using, you know, it's up to you to nurture the fire, gather more logs or twigs, make sure that, you know, you don't piss on it, and that make sure that Matt doesn't piss on it when he's drunk, because he does that, you know what I'm saying? Like, and starts to put it out and thinks it's funny.
Yeah. Well, I will.
So
I will...
think that, I guess the big.
Go ahead.
I was going to say the big takeaway is, what was I going to say? Oh, yeah. That. I forget. Never mind.
Okay. So I'll say, cause we have a little mini thing that Marco brought up that we wanted to get to, the little second mini topic, and we're running out of time. So I would say my favorite things that you could say about this is you need to teach your kids to be brave. You need to teach your kids to be confident. You need to teach your kids to try, and you need to teach your kids to put in the work and the effort. Those things, and I know it looks like I'm jerking off, but I'm petting the dog to keep her quiet.
I'm like, what's happening over there? We went to the bathroom one, and you don't even care to go to the bathroom for some fucking self-indulgent moment.
I told you, I have to babysit my daughter's dog while she's at work while I'm doing this, and she wants to talk to you guys. Anyway, teach your kids to be brave. Teach your kids to be confident. Teach your kids to try. Teach your kids to fail. Because what I was always told by an elderly man who shall remain nameless is that you will learn more from humble failures than you will from arrogant success. And if your apprentice learned that she had to work on her skills and prepare herself with work and effort to the point where she was ready to become an apprentice. If that's what she learned from her first rejection by you, then that first rejection was A, the right thing to do, and B, healthy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I did it on purpose. Honestly, I know I joke around, but it was my intention to, I saw a little bit of myself in her. It was always my intention to bring her on as an apprentice. But she needed to prove her to herself, and she needed to prove to me that she could put on her big girl pants, come back and really show that she wanted. And she did. And she is a great, great artist. Art of singleness.
And Marco's mini topic for the close of the episode. Things you should never do naked.
Yeah, I fucking just.
Oh, I got one. I got the obvious
we
one.
We were talking podcast. Back and forth. Oh, yeah. Well, a live.
Oh, the obvious one is you should never fry bacon in a cast iron skillet.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh, yeah. That's really bad.
So, I would say never bathe your dog naked.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
never bathe your dog naked. Because dogs are inherently curious.
Oh, yeah.
How about never answer the door for trick-or-treaters naked? Strong. That'll get you put on a list, probably.
That'll get you, yeah.
That'll get you thrown in jail really quick.
You'll have to be put on a registry.
I would say never public speaking. You know what I'm saying? Don't be a motivational speaker. A naked motivational speaker.
Unless it's at a nudist colony, then that would be appropriate.
Never spank your kids naked.
No.
At a certain age, just don't be around your kids naked, period. You know what I'm saying? Like,
well, yeah. I mean, I'm around my son naked, and he's around me naked, because I always tell him, kid, we're guys, you know, locker room.
It's a locker room. Yeah.
My wife and daughter can be around each other naked, but at some point, fathers and daughters are not permitted to be around each other naked, and vice versa.
That's true. That's very true.
Correct.
It's kind of creepy.
Welding. You should never weld naked.
Oh, that's a good one.
That's even worse than the bacon. Jojo.
You should never check your lobster traps naked.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Catfish noodling. You should never go noodling for catfish naked. I'm just saying.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Does anybody have any final thoughts on the big lie of self-esteem?
Yes, no matter how much you try to masturbate with a cheese grater, it's not going to boost your confidence.
Oh. Ew.
Oh, I just crossed my legs. Okay.
All right, wait. On that note, I have to tell you, because you all know I love jokes, and jokes are a dying art form. So are you ready for one of my grandpa's jokes?
Here we go. Hit it.
Okay. Guy comes home from work, and he tells his wife, he says, "Sonny, I got fired from the deli today." And she goes, "Really? What happened?" And he goes, "Well, it's really embarrassing." And she says, "Why?" And he says, they caught me sticking my dick in the pickle slicer." And she goes, "What?" And he goes, "Yeah, they caught me sticking my dick in the pickle slicer. And they were like, that's unacceptable. You're fired." And she goes, "Oh my God, is your dick okay?" And he goes, "Oh yeah, my dick's fine." And she says, "What happened to the pickle slicer?" And he says, "They fired her too."
Fantastic.
Amazing.
Oh, and on that note.
Yeah.
Matt, you want to take us home?
Take us home.
Take us out.
Take us out. All right. Well, you can follow us on the socials, which clearly you are if you're watching this. Mm-hmm. You could hit us up either with a direct message. You can slide in our DMs there. We like that. And you can also email us at, I always forget this email address, I don't know why, lockerroommailbag@gmail.com. You can hit us up there. But we're pretty active on the socials, so we'll probably see that first.
Yeah, easiest way to Instagram or Facebook DMs are probably the easiest way.
Yeah, yeah, those are the easiest ways. And join us every motherfucking Thursday. Yep. And
our next episode, I think we're going to answer some, we've gotten some messages, we've got some questions we have to answer, so that'll be fun. So our next episode, I guess we'll see y'all in the locker room.
Hell yeah.
Bye.
See you soon.